Yeah. So in terms of the key numbers, so over 15,000 delegates attended the conference from 175 countries. It's hardly to imagine. It's really, really global event with also quite high level representation. We had over 60, we called VIPs, yeah, which means high representatives from the governments and president, leaders of the countries, and celebrities. Over 150 sessions were conducted, 120 satellites, and 26 pre-conferences. Over 2,700 abstracts were presented, and over 1,200 scholarships were awarded. So looking conference participants breakdown by region, we see that representatives from our region, Eastern Europe and Central Asia, constituted 6% of the participants. It's not a lot. I expected more because this conference was in Europe. Nevertheless, it's still quite substantial representation, taking into account the overall number of participants, 15,000. So at the same time, I really encourage you to pass the message about the upcoming conference to increase participation from the from our region. In terms of affiliation of the participants, it's interesting that the largest column of participants, the largest number, was from NGOs, non-governmental organizations. You see on the left, the black column. Then from academia and from governmental institutions. It's also quite illustrative. In terms of the scholarship, you see that participants were broken down by affiliation and links to the representation of being some of key populations or different kind of affiliations. But getting back to our region, to the scholarship, actually, if you look at the scholarship received by participants from our region, the largest part was from Sub-Saharan Africa, but we see also Eastern Europe and Central Asia received over 9% of the scholarship. Getting back to the key highlights, the conference really was a powerful, inspirational and scientific instrument to look at situation in our countries, in our region. What can be done, what new things we can take from the conference in order to change the situation in the region overall, which is nearly the only region, or the only two regions along with MENA, where HIV epidemic is still growing. This is happening in the context of decreasing international funding. We know Global Fund is the major HIV donor and TB donor for the region, is gradually transitioning from our countries. And we need to acknowledge that in several countries in our region, there are some restrictive policies which doesn't allow to implement evidence-based scientific interventions, such as, for example, methadone substitution therapy in the countries where it's critically needed, like Russian Federation, for example. There are also human rights related barriers, especially linked to access to services for key population, because in our region we have concentrated epidemic. So to the extent how effectively we will address, provide services to all marginalized and key populations, it will cause success or not success in addressing HIV epidemic. I inserted several photos I actually took from the conference, and one was from a plenary session Anna Dryabina presented, who is with us today, because her presentation was specifically on ECA. I have to admit that there was no special regional session. We had several regional sessions in the past, bilingual, English and Russian, in order to achieve maximum engagement of those who are not English speakers at the previous conferences. At this one, we didn't have a specifically dedicated session for Eastern Europe and Central Asia. Nevertheless, as it was promised, focus on ECA was actually quite highlighted across the conference. So in my presentation, I also will draw your attention to this. And specifically at the one of the days, the conference days, at the plenary, there were several highlights from Anna's presentation I also referring to. The key thing is that key populations, people who inject drugs, sex workers, and men having sex with men are key drivers of the epidemic in our region. So looking at the context of Europe, broader Europe, or even globally, we see how critical it is to provide services to 1.6 or 1.7 million people who inject drugs, who are mostly underserved in our region. Well, it's not a secret that majority of this group lives in Russian Federation, so this message is also highlights how important to do something meaningful and effective there. If you look at the again, the slide from the same presentation of Anna, look at the sex worker picture. You see, well, there are really dark red spots in several sub-Saharan African countries. But in terms of the scale, you see our region is dark red as well. So this is illustrates the global burden of HIV among female sex workers. When we look at the MSM, well, for many countries, there is a growing trend in modeling, forecasting, or even observing or forecasting increase of new infections among MSM. And one of the constituting factors was a combination of drug use with the risk behavior. So we see also on the slide how kind of link, for example, with chemsex and having multiple sexual partners in the last 3 months, or getting involved in group sex, how this combination increasing risk of HIV transmission, and this should be addressed as well. In terms of looking at key populations, actually, this is a highlight from another presentation from the side session run by AIDS Fonds and International HIV AIDS Alliance, which now Frontline AIDS, showing, it's not so visible, but KP accounts for 47 new infections globally, but in terms of resources, only 2% of HIV funding and 9% of prevention funding goes for key population. So it's also one of the highlights very relevant to the region. And another risky tendency is actually dropping of funding for key population. So it's very dangerous trend that despite of increase of the funding, actually we observe drop of the funding by 18% for the last 2 years. And in terms of HIV spending breakdown for specific key populations groups for different components, actually what was presented, the table with the question marks. So it's another signal that we still lacking reliable information both about estimates but also tracing the level of funding actually allocated for the most affected groups. Looking at the topics, another highlight I would like to make is on TB. There were a number of sessions devoted to HIV TB and even TB as a standalone issues, issue. It's a good signal because as was mentioned also by Dr. Amiran earlier that integrating approach is getting more and more valid, and with TB it's so critical that without addressing TB we couldn't effectively deal with HIV and vice versa. This is a diagram not from from our region, nevertheless it's quite illustrative. It presents gap in TB detection and TB preventive treatment for people who are newly enrolled in HIV care. This shows a slide with high burden countries, but actually you might see even this green part of the columns, it's actually the gap in TB detection among people with HIV enrolled in care. So we observed this actually in our context as well, that working on HIV-TB is really critical for both, for benefits of both, effective addressing TB and HIV. At the conference, some of the highlights I would like to make that preventive therapy was widely discussed, MDR-TB recommendations, including new treatment regimes, and also for co-infection using dolutegravir for patients with TB co-infection. So it was in particular presenting as a part of the inspiring study. Another highlight was pick up from the conference is a transition. It was not at the very big focus on the conference, but in the context of our region, many countries were transitioning. And I put this photo because it was a joint session on HIV and law. But the good thing that transition was in focus of this session, and this is an example from Ukraine where Deputy Prime Minister attended, so it's quite high level we didn't observe at the conferences before, along with PEPFAR and Global Fund representatives. So it was an illustration not only of sharing and scientific discussion, but actually it was part of the policy and advocacy efforts, because at this session actually Deputy Prime Minister made a firm commitment heard by everyone, recorded actually because many people recorded about funding allocation for key population, and it's happening now. So I am actually quite proud of this example, how we can use this kind of conferences also for not only for scientific discussions, but also for moving things forward and introducing some policy changes. There was also, I don't remember from which session it was, but it was a transition slide from Georgia. I also took photo from the one of the sessions with the timeline, and it's also quite good that Georgia also publicly shared through through presentations these plans on the transition. Yeah, I also would like to mention this educational fund meeting, the meeting itself, but also during the regional meetings we had at the conference, we dedicated some time to discuss educational fund agenda. It's important to allocate some time during the conference to attend these meetings as well, because it's an important instrument to learn and to discuss further plans, especially within your regional colleagues. There is also another kind of side effect, yeah, or side possibility of making connections. It's a great opportunity of networking and meeting people, learning beyond the agenda, but also making some political connections. For example, here, mayor of Amsterdam is actually, she was quite approachable, and there was a discussion on the cities project with her. Amsterdam is a partner of this program. The program actually implemented in five cities, including Tbilisi, the city where we are, and also Odessa, Almaty, and Belts and Sofia. This is also the reference to the Fast Track Cities presentation of one of the city representatives, deputy mayor from Kiev. I think for them it was also an eye-opening event, because it was the first conference he attended, and he was quite impressed with the level of discussion, and got higher commitment than it was before. Well, another perspective is messages from celebrities, including Conchita Wurst, and all celebrities actually, especially for key populations in terms of how to deal with stigma and discrimination, also peer support, and how to deal with the status, all the things were important, as well as human rights agenda. I'm very proud that my colleague Alan Maleche from Kelen, from Kenya, received Elizabeth Taylor Foundation Award. And it was very important for all of us, from civil society in particular, acknowledging this work on addressing human rights violations, both in the area of TB and HIV. Well, gender agenda was quite discussed, especially in regard to women who inject drugs, how, even in comparison with men, how they are facing discrimination and risk of treatment, OST treatment interruption during the pregnancy, or issues like violence. So there were a number of things which were also presented at the plenary sessions, with some highlights capturing diversity of women who inject drugs in terms of tailoring services according to their needs. So it's one of the issues which was also brought at the conference, how important to have tailored services according to the needs, gender, age also, and thus it could help. In terms of new interventions, innovations, highlights, self-testing was of course much widely and substantially discussed than before, than 2 years back, with a focus on self-testing with MSM and transgender women. Several examples were presented where kind of prejudice were addressed. Prejudice, for example, with the self-test, we couldn't guarantee a referral to medical institutions. It's quite widespread opinion, but with community distribution of self-tests, there were several studies, in particular in Zambia and Malawi, showed nearly the same referral rate as for regular testing. Using pharmacies were also presented for distributing self-test kit based on French experience. Another highlight was how to deal with not key population, not specific group, but just youth with risk behavior, experimenting with drugs and sex. They prefer not to be called drug user or MSM. Yeah, so it's new approaches which were presented at the several sessions, including drugstore project with online counseling and information service, HIV testing, and also drug checking service, and reaching out youth, not at the NGO or with outreach routes, but during a music festival, during a club, parties, etc. Also in a form different, with no standard leaflets, but rather bottle of water, which is really needed to avoid dehydration. So it's actually quite important difference from the previous conference that youth was substantially more represented at the age 18 than at the previous conferences, both with the scholarship but also during the sessions. In terms of innovations, several technology innovations were presented with the smartphone applications, with online campaigns and internet-based self-testing model, using targeting groups in Facebook community. So all these interventions worked quite well, and this is also a pick up for our region, because we of course can learn from each other, but it's important to learn from the world what worked in other countries and how we can adjust and apply this. This is a slide illustrating effectiveness of opioid substitution therapy, which six times more effective and 12 times more cost effective in comparison with a repressive drug policy detention. So the policy is also a very important part, because we are here representing the science, evidence-based science intervention, and it's very dangerous when ideology or prejudice prevails over science. It's very risky, and this is an issue we also need to address in our region. Well, in regard to the PrEP, I am very glad that all actually major studies show it effectiveness of the PrEP, and there are several new wave PrEP innovations were presented, like long-active injectable PrEP, it's also implants, and broadly neutralized antibodies. So it's if you look at the map, our region is not visible introducing PrEP. At the same time, yes, we are very glad and acknowledging that I think Georgia was first country in Eastern Europe and Central Asia started PrEP. PrEP is also available in Ukraine now. Also, we started in one city of Kiev and now scaling up to the entire country with the Global Fund support. Our region was in focus also due to several media events and celebrity events, particularly Elton John AIDS Foundation announced new funding for Russia and the region called Lighthouse and other interventions. So I think it actually quite a significant event, and it was announced together with Chris Bayer and other colleagues, so with some links to IAS. So I think it's very important that new funding is coming to Russia Federation to address program for key populations. It's not easy for donors to enter this country. Nevertheless, Elton John, due to his charm, managed to do this. And the program actually, as of now, have started in several Russian cities. Well, youth participation, including youth representative from our region, was also at the plenary session, not only in the Global Village or special trainings, but also I'm glad that there was a really good session with HIV positive young people sharing their experience. In terms of the treatment, there were several highlights and key studies on monotherapy and several other studies. In terms of topics, I would like to highlight particularly that ART for children was also specifically discussed, and for pregnancy, during the pregnancy, and also for TB co-infection, HIV TB co-infection. I mentioned already this on TB slide. Well, big topic was U equals U. Undetectable means untransmittable. For the first time, I saw also the T-shirt. Yeah, some people adjusting this slogan for the region. So in Russian, it means неопределяемый, значит непередающий. It's also was good because this concept is not widely actually spread, U equals U or N равно N. At the same time, I specifically brought this as one of the highlights actually to look on the national strategic plans, strategic priorities in our countries, how this concept used at the national response. This is very worrying slide from Europe, from 1990 cascade. So we see amazing results in Western Europe, where cascade is very close to 1990, it's actually 86, 90, 92, and 72. Then in the central Europe, which is mostly involves EU countries like Poland, Czech Republic, Slovakia, Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria, also Turkey is there. So the cascade is not so good, but still 83, 73, 78, and then 45 undetectable viral load. If we look at our region, Eastern Europe and Central Asia, so the figures are 76, 46, 72, and 26. So undetectable viral load percentage is only 26%. Even with the first figures, I actually doubt that they are correct, especially knowing that some discrepancies exist between estimated figures and real number of key populations and people living with HIV. So it's a major warning point, because we have this 90-90-90 target around the corner for 2020, and our region is far behind in reaching this. So all these interventions, evidence-based interventions, should be applied more effectively and intensively at the larger scale. At the same time, focus on integration sounded from a number of important speakers. One was Bill Clinton, former US president, who spoke actually on TB-HIV integration and more broadly on integrated approach. It was also a special session of IAS Lancet Commission. And at this session, modeling harm reduction interventions for people who inject drugs in Russia was presented by Javier Cepeda from San Diego. And there was very, very rich discussion on the importance of using specific interventions which work, namely the modeling which was presented showed that the two major cities where the study was conducted, in Yekaterinburg and Omsk, with MAT or OST, medication-assisted treatment, or opioid substitution therapy. It's one intervention. Needle syringe exchange program, which is an SP and ART. And with these three interventions, and with reaching out 50% of people who inject drugs, we will get results in decreasing infections by 36% in one city and 53% in another. So this is one important highlight from that session. Another is that TB-HIV integration is a key issue, and TB accounts for more than 40% of all deaths among people living with HIV. At the same time, funding is decreasing. We saw the funding decrease by 20% over the last 3 years. So integration is not a luxury, it's also a way to use limited resources for multiple purposes. So that's why it's critical to look on synergies, how we can address multiple issues with the same resources. And looking on the chart for cascade, we see also that our region, which is fourth from the left, is with the our cascade has worse, the most problematic situation in comparison with other countries. So this is also a message that we don't have too much time, but we really need to intensify with support of the conference finding, intensify our work on the ground, bringing science to implementation, applying science rather than ideology. Thank you so much. Yeah.